Hello, my name is Audrey Hendricks, and this is Brianna Coltellino, and we're presenting on the role of the School of Communication Science and Disorders in community engagement. So, as I said, my name is Audrey Hendricks. I am a second-year master's student here at the School of Communication Science and Disorders. I'm applying for the PhD right now, but I'm also really enjoying clinical work here. So I have research experience in early intervention, school-age populations, and older adults. My primary research interests, though, are literacy, and I'm looking forward to finishing my degree here and then potentially going on to the PhD program.
Hello, my name is Brianna Coltellino. I am a second-year doctoral student here at Florida State University in the School of Communication, Science, and Disorders. Similar to Audrey, I completed my undergraduate degree here, and I also completed my master's degree. So I'm now a null for life, a triple null. My research interests are kind of similar. I am into early intervention, so that's what I do clinically, and then outside of the clinic, I'm also engaged in research working with individuals who have developmental disabilities, and specifically those who are between birth and 5 years old right now. Your funding, which I'll talk about later, has helped to support me during my time in the PhD, but I've also been honored to be a part of a few grants that have helped me both within the master's and the PhD programs to allow me financial support to continue on in my studies. And yeah, we can move on to the next. So, really quickly, we just want to broadly overview what a speech language pathologist actually does. Our CSD program encompasses individuals who are going to be working as speech language pathologist and also audiologist. So, starting with what a speech language pathologist or an SLP does, we really do education, advocacy, prevention, diagnostic, and treatment across the lifespan. And so that's the one thing we want you guys to take away from today is that we are working with individuals across their life, from the little ones like I'm working with as newborns, all the way into older geriatric years. And we kind of have our big nine areas of communication, language, and speech that we can treat within. And so, just the idea that the work that we do is really important and it impacts a lot of people. So, what you are helping support is directly helping others in the community. So, within our undergraduate program, we'd like to start there because our undergraduates are really the largest program that we have. And we have 90 students within each of our two cohorts. That's roughly 180 students that come through our undergraduate program each year. And they do a lot of fantastic work out in the community that we'd like to highlight. So, we'll start with NISLA. That is our largest organization, and that stands for the National Student Speech, Language, and Hearing Association. It's directly tied to ASHA, which is the American Speech, Language, Hearing Association, but specifically to support students at the undergraduate master's years. And so, for our NISLA organization here on campus, we primarily, all of the CSD students pretty much get involved in this. And one of their big things, their big initiatives that they're doing out in the community right now is partnering with the HOPE Coalition. And this is the Big Bend Homeless Shelter. And so what they do is allow our students to come in and work with their children who are staying there with them. So our students will actually have weekly creating materials and picking what books they're going to read, and they go out to the HOPE area here in Tallahassee, and they will do literacy activities with the kids, shared book reading, engaging in activities that have to do with the books to make a really rich literacy experience for the children that are there. And that's something that our students really pride themselves on and enjoy going to do each week. Then we have SAA, which is another student organization that undergraduates typically get involved in. This is the Student Academy of Audiology. Their big thing that they do, and they've done it each year with COVID, it got a little wonky, but typically they head out to Guatemala and they do what's called Help Guatemala Hear. It's their biggest service project. And Ms. Dr. Selena Snowden will take around 15 to 20 students down there to Guatemala and provide audiological services. I was honored to go on this trip a few years back, and it's quite amazing to see the work that we're able to do to truly impact people who have possibly never seen a doctor in their life. And now we're able to go in there and not only provide hearing screenings and help with things like wax impaction to help their hearing, but we can also give them devices. So the money that we're able to get and fundraise beforehand helps us to actually go to Guatemala and really impact people's lives by giving them access to hearing. Now I'm going to turn it over to Audrey to talk about a few more of our organizations.
So another student organization that helps a specific population is Operation Smile. Operation Smile is connected to a larger organization globally, which helps fundraise and then support children who are getting surgery to repair their cleft lip and palate. So a cleft lip and a cleft palate means that the child's, the top of the roof of their mouth or their lips didn't fully close during prenatal development. So this is very problematic for the child when they try to eat or when they try to learn to talk. So these children desperately need surgery and they also need support afterwards. So Operation Smile helps both fundraise and then, as you can see here, write card, get well cards, or go on supplies drives for these children that need the surgery. And then the next club is the ASL Club, or the American Sign Language Club. American Sign Language is its own language with a grammatical structure that is different from English. Some part of speech therapy, sometimes speech therapists work with clients who have hearing loss, and some of these clients do use American Sign Language. But because it is a language distinct from English, these students need a chance to gain familiarity with American Sign Language. So the ASL Club hosts voice-off nights where they solely communicate their American Sign Language, and they also bring awareness to the language itself to help make sure that people understand that it is a language and that they can learn it. At the master's level, community engagement takes a more formal turn. The master's program for on-campus students is 2 years long. During the first year, all of the students take academic coursework, and they also work at the speech and hearing clinic underneath clinical supervisors. So at the speech and hearing clinic, they're getting to help students that may not be able to afford services elsewhere, students or adults. And they get to work with a variety of populations, like Brianna said earlier, everything from birth to our geriatric patients. And during the second year, all of the students go out to different community placements where I am now. So that might be a school, it might be a hospital, it might be a private practice. But there, we are getting direct involvement in the community and helping treat a variety of disorders in a variety of populations. And then besides the direct clinical work, there are a number of outreaches that the master's students engage in. So one of them is speech and hearing screenings, going out to, say, schools, or other locations where students might need to be identified for possible assessment and treatment. And then they also ally with a number of other organizations, such as the Sports Ability Alliance, to help adults with disabilities gain access to outdoor adventures, or Delta Zeta to help host holiday events for children with hearing loss. My personal favorite, and the one that I have been involved in the most, is Rock City Boxing, where every Friday one of our clinical teams will go out to a gym here in Tallahassee, and they will work with a Parkinson's group that does exercise work, and they also help them practice their voice to help these patients have a better quality of life and have community engagement and stay fit, and then also maintain the intelligibility that they need to communicate.
Now we transition on to our last program, which is the doctoral program. What's really fantastic about this is that it's quite honestly a really large doctoral program considering within the field. So we currently have 17 doctoral students across 10 different labs, and that's give or take, that's my estimation. But we have around 17 students working in around 10 labs. And so that's really exciting. And the idea is that the work that we do within our research is not only just reaching close-knit to our clinic, but we're really broadening out and trying to bring our research to the larger populations of people who could benefit from the work. So there are a lot of things that our students are doing, a lot of wonderful projects that students are taking on to branch that work out to the community. A great example is Dr. Lakeisha Johnson and her doctoral students going out into the community and working with librarians and going to these local libraries to speak to families about engaging in better literacy practices and shared book reading. Students are always, and we see some articles here, getting recognized for their work through CCI. So another great way to check out what the students are doing is keeping up with the CCI website to see some of that great work and the way that's being published. So, yeah.
So looking at community engagement on a more individual level, I can use my experience as sort of a one student snapshot of the community engagement that goes on for all of our master's students. So right now I am at a school, I'm actually at Childs High School, and every day when I go to Childs, I'm helping students who may have disabilities like Down syndrome, or they may have trouble with literacy, learning to read. Or they just may have trouble pronouncing their words. And my job is to help them, help my supervisor, teach them what they need to know to be successful in life as they approach graduation. And then every other student in my cohort is involved in a similar experience, whether that's a school or a hospital. So when we come together at classes, we share our experiences and we share the problems that we're having so that we can better help each other give the best quality care to our clients in Tallahassee and then beyond, even up to South Georgia. So another thing that all of the second year master's students are doing is they're starting to help the first year master's students gain the skills. For example, here you see me helping a student learn how to perform a hearing screening. This is a skill that they will need to be able to bring services to many different populations and identify students or adults that need further assessment. Another thing that all of our master's students do is they engage in some sort of research. So I myself am working on a thesis, and I am mentoring two undergraduate students. One of them is in our, or applying to our undergraduate program. Another is in neuroscience, a different major. But I'm getting to help teach them the research skills that they will need to be successful in whatever field that they decide to choose. And then I'm hoping to present my research at conferences, such as this one, potentially the Scientific Studies of Reading in Denmark. If I am accepted, then I'll be going to Denmark this summer to present my findings to the greater research community in America and beyond, so that I can both share what we've been working on and learn from them to help better assessment and intervention practices across our field. And many of our students in the master's and doctoral programs regularly go to conferences to both share what they are working on and learn from faculty and other students so that they can become better researchers and they can contribute to improving the best practices in our field.
Okay. Now, similar to Audrey, I am kind of an example of another student who's been supported in the past financially and has gone out and done a bunch of things in the community. So I'm talking about my journey here and really this idea that the journey has only just begun as I'm only, I say only, I've been here for so long, but I'm in my second year of the master, or the doctoral program, and there's still so much out there for me to do, and it's very exciting. So that picture was taken a little over a year ago, actually probably exactly 1 year ago, where I finished teaching my first group of undergraduate students. So it's been really exciting time for me to take what I'm learning in the classroom and now get to share it with others and help them learn as well to really motivate and inspire those next group of clinicians. Here is me working with one of my sweet babies, and so I'm really enjoying being an early interventionist and taking what I'm doing and truly going out and making a difference in the lives of these children, especially in such transformative years. I also have taken on a role within the past year as the assistant advisor of NISLA, and so it's just been wonderful to be able to get back in touch with the undergraduates and truly, again, just another way for me to mentor and get experience in working hand in hand with them and seeing what those needs are to get out in the community and helping make that happen. So it's been really nice to stay connected in that kind of way. Of course, like Audrey was talking about before, one of the big things that we do is actually present our work. So I've now had multiple opportunities starting in undergraduate and throughout my master's years, and now even in the PhD, not only getting hands-on experience within a lab to do the work, but then going out and really bringing that work to a larger group of people. So I've been everywhere from Orlando and now most recently to Cancun, Mexico. I was up in Boston a few weeks ago. And so it's just been really fantastic to see the work that I'm doing coming together in a way that I can share with other people and kind of help the better, larger population out there. And so now currently, I'm working with my advisors, Dr. Andrea Barnholsey and Dr. Michelle Therrien, and another PhD advisor, Dr. Molly Romano, on their project, which is this developmental disabilities database. And so I have been an integral part in helping see those children between 6 months and 5 years old to help give a battery of assessments and really send them off into the world, understanding kind of how we can support their communication as they grow and kind of keeping track of them over time to see how they're growing throughout the years. So I just want the takeaway from this to also be that the funding that we receive really helps us go out into the world and make a difference. And so we thank you guys for giving us these opportunities to make this big impact. So with that, we would love to stay connected. And so we have lots of ways for you all to be able to see what our students are doing, all the great things we're doing out there. So here are some QR codes that you can scan with your phones. We can also find a way to get these links up to everybody. But these are links to some of those student organizations that we talked about today. We also now recently have an Instagram page for our FSU Speech and Hearing Clinic to see what we're doing off campus in our clinic.
All right, here are some of the references we used when compiling this presentation. And we also wanted to point out that there are a number of ways to find out more about what speech therapists do in general, but also what our faculty and our students are doing. So the best place to learn about what a speech therapist does is to go to the ASHA website, the American Speech Language Hearing Association website, because they have so much information on what our field does. And then there's also the School of Communication, Science, and Disorders now has their own newsletter. And the faculty recently put out a very good summary of their research when they were recruiting master's students to work in their labs this past semester. So these are potential places that you could look to learn more about the research that's going on, but also what we're doing clinically, and then what the field is doing as a whole. And then lastly, we wanted to say thank you. Thank you so much for your funding and for your support, and also for listening to this presentation. We are so glad to have you. Thank you very much, and have a wonderful day.